Good evening. I'm interim dean Don Goldfarb of the engineering school. And I'd like to thank Michael Delaney and Marlene Yamashita from Boeing for taking the time to speak to us this evening. Michael Delaney is vice president of engineering at Boeing Commercial Airplanes. And Marlene Yamashita is director of ethics and business conduct for Boeing Commercial Airplanes. I'm looking forward to the discussion on the topic of ethics. I don't know if you realize, but Boeing has been long synonymous with integrity in its products and its business practices. Principal leadership yields principal practices at all levels of the organization. We are privileged today to hear from them. Boeing's senior level leadership will, I hope, let us know how they deal with imposing, well, not, I shouldn't say imposing, but encouraging ethical behavior throughout their organization. So please welcome me in joining in, join me in welcoming both Michael and Marlene today at CS.
Well, thanks for spending the evening with Marlene and myself. And what we thought we would do is, as opposed to just be standing up there and boring you with 1,000 PowerPoints, you'll have your whole career to do that, right? We figured we'd just sort of have a little bit of a dialogue here with you tonight and then open it up to questions and answers at the end so we can get your feedback and engage you in the subject. What we're going to talk about, Marlene's going to ask some questions and I'm going to field the answers. But I thought I'd start with, the discussion was ethics in engineering and ethics in the workplace. And, sort of disclosure, so if you go back and you look at the word ethics, it's of Greek origin, and it talks about character, the fundamental belief of character. And what I'm going to talk to you about tonight is sort of the character of my company. I full disclosure, I've only worked in the aerospace industry my entire career. So I'm an aerodynamics guy by training, and I've spent most of my time working on commercial airplanes, although I have worked on the military side for a little bit. So the examples are going to be around airplanes and aerodynamics and aerospace, but hopefully they have broader application for you tonight. And we'll try to talk to them in that context. So with that, I'll turn it over to Marlene and we can start the discussion.
So let me just thank you for attending this tonight. It's great to be here. And with Mike, I would like you to know that ethics and engineering, the ethics group actually has been partnering with our engineering leaders. And we have been going to select universities around in the U.S. And Columbia is one of the few universities that we've selected to come and share with you. And I want you to know that I intentionally asked Mike to partner with me at Columbia because Mike is a person who actually, he and I sit on the same leadership team, and that's, we report to the president and CEO of Boeing Commercial Airplanes. And I get to see Mike in meetings and where we're talking about just casual business things, important things, but also more complex and more complicated issues. And I've gotten to know Mike and observe him in those meetings. And for me, the reason why Mike, it was important for Mike to be here, was because I have seen him be a leader of character. And so I thought that you would really benefit from hearing from him this evening. So we're going to start with a question. And Mike, how long have you been at in the aerospace business now?
Since 85.
85, so how many years is that?
You want me to do math tonight?
Yeah, well, maybe one of you can do it for us. What is it? Yeah, 27. And so, I thought about this last night before we came today, and I thought, my gosh, some of those students weren't even born. when you started your career.
When I started my career. Are you trying to warm yourself up to me?
And the reason I say this is because what I hope that you're going to leave with tonight is a good sense of what examples and what Mike's going to share with you, that it will demonstrate that his career has been a good fit for him, and that he's experienced things, the opportunities, but also the challenges, and he will talk about that. So perhaps that's something you can take away from, some learnings, but also how his past positions, and he's had many, various positions at Boeing, how it's prepared him to be the leader that he is today and created the kind of success for him. So I'm hoping that you're going to walk away tonight with that sense. But let's start with the first question, Mike. Now, you were appointed to manage a special team that was focused on maintenance and inspections of airplane fuel systems following the loss of TWA Flight 800. Now, for those of you in the audience, that was a terrible crash that involved a Boeing 747 that killed 230 people. And that was in 1996. And it happened actually 12 minutes after the flight flew out of JFK. So Mike, being on that team meant that you had a difficult task of implementing a solution within Boeing and across the fleet. So could you tell us how you dealt with such a significant issue while the entire world was watching?
So, sure, Marlene. So TWA 100 was a pretty tragic event for lots of reasons, and 230 people lost their lives. The airplane, just for background, took off after out of JFK, bound for Paris, and the airplane blew up about 12 minutes after takeoff. What we know is that the center tank of the airplane exploded. So if you know the design of the airplane, you have the wing, and then the part of the wing that's in the fuselage or the body of the airplane, and then the other wing, and there's three major fuel tanks, and the center tank is the one that's in the body of the airplane. So what we were able to determine was that the center tank did explode. The NTSB and Boeing and the investigative team never really understood what initiated the event. We just know from the way that the wreckage happened that it was an explosion in the center tank. It was a very long investigation, and out of that came some rules that they're called the SFARs, or the Special Federal Aviation Regulations, and one of them was SFAR 88, which required the manufacturers to go through and look at their designs completely from a different perspective and from a safety analysis, and then look at the maintenance and the manufacturing practices and all the things that enable the airplane to remain safe. And I was tasked with that, to lead that program as the program manager. And it involved not just the 747, but all of the type designs. So the 737, 747, 757, as well as the legacy Douglas airplanes, the DC-8, 9, and 10. And so the thing was, what the fundamental rule said was, go do these safety assessments and identify ignition sources or potential ignition sources in the fuel tank. And that was a matter of basically going through the design and understanding what were not only the failure modes, but also some of the environmental modes that could enable an ignition source to exist in the airplane. And then the rule also had this other piece that said, look at latent failures, which are failures that are not announced to the flight deck or to the crew, plus an active failure. So when we started it, we thought most of the work was going to be in this latent, what was called latent plus ones. And I had a discussion with my predecessor, Hank Queen, who had this job, and said, you know, Hank, if we find any single point failures to a top level event, I'll be really surprised at that. And he said, I will too. So we got through going through the analysis of all the airplanes, and we actually did find some single point failures, so a single failure that could lead to a top level event or an airplane event level. And that was pretty disturbing. And so one time we had a meeting, and it was sort of one of those seminal meetings you have in your career. And Hank and I were sitting in a conference room, and we were looking at the results. We were coming back from the safety assessments. And he looked at me and said, when you're done, can you assure that, now TWA was the accident that actually had the fatalities, but there were two other accidents. There was a 737 in the Philippines that actually had exploded on the ground and nobody was killed. And then there was another event in Thailand that happened about the after TWA 800. So there were three events, airplanes, where we couldn't explain what actually happened. So Hank said to me, he said, can you assure me that after all the work you've done, that you could have precluded any one of those three accidents from happening? And so fundamentally, he was asking me the question, can you predict unknown unknowns? And I said to him, Hank, you know I can't do that. And he said, so your work isn't done yet. He goes, you have to go figure out an independent path or an independent way so that even if an ignition source exists in one of our airplanes, we can preclude that an event from happening. Now that led to a subsequent program, which we weren't by law required to do, which was to inert the tanks or put a system on the airplane that generates nitrogen enriched air, and nitrogen, as you know, is an inert gas, and so you flood the ullage or the space in the tank such that the tank is not flammable, it's no longer stoichiometric. Now that was an incredibly unpopular decision because of several reasons. One, this was in the wake of September 11th, so most of this rule work was being done in about 2001, 2003 timeframe. So the airlines and a lot of people were coming back from really the heels of what happened on September 11th. The estimates were potentially up to $1 billion to retrofit all the airplanes in the fleet. So the numbers were pretty big in terms of the economic impact to the airlines. And there was some question about people whether, because if you remember, TWA was sort of in trouble, and there were some questions about whether their maintenance practices and whether or not really it was, because the airplane involved was like the 23rd, I think it was the 23rd or 25th 747 ever built. So we got to this point where Hank said, can you preclude it? He said, no. So he goes, you've got a year to develop this nitrogen generation system, and that's your assignment. And then you wound up in these series of meetings with the leadership of the company, and the person who was leading the company at the time was a guy named Alan Mulally, who's now the CEO of Ford. And the thing that impressed me was Alan knew all the pressure that was coming from the airlines and the economics. He knew that we were going to put a system on the airplane that was going to be a couple hundred thousand dollars unit cost increase to the airplanes at a time when we were recovering from September 11th. And Alan, you have all those kind of meetings where everybody's chirping, right? And it was funny because, I was a young executive and Alan said, stop. This is the way we're going to do it, guys. Mike's going to present the data and then we're going to make a decision whether it's safe or not. Then the second thing we're going to do is we're going to decide what the right thing to do for the airplane is. And then the third thing is businessmen, we're going to go figure out the consequences of those first two decisions. But we will not allow the business consequences to impact whether or not we do the right thing for the airplane. And everybody on this room better get on board with that mindset. And it was interesting because as soon as Alan set that tone, people still went from, complaining or trying to to rationalize why we didn't have to do it, to getting into a discussion about, okay, this is what we need to do, this is the right thing to do. And then Hank said something to me one time afterwards. He goes, Mike, look, our airplanes do wonderful things. They connect the world, the economy is built on it. And he goes, and I know that sometimes people are gonna be dire injured on our products. He goes, but what I can't stand is for somebody to happen to them twice because we didn't do everything we could to make it right. And the lesson there was, you at some point you have to run a business, but at some point you have to understand that there's the right way to run a business, and there's the right decision-making process, and there's a right frame of mind to approach that decision-making process. And quite honestly, you know, later on when I was chief engineer of the 737, you'd be in many of those decisions where you're running a safety board and stuff was coming in from the fleet, and you have to think about, okay, what do we need to do here that's the right thing to do for the airplane and for the flying public? And then we'll go figure out the business consequences and how we mitigate those some way in a different discussion. And you got to separate those things.
Mm-hmm. What a dilemma to be in. That's great. So, Mike, you brought up being the 737 chief engineer, and you were involved in some really tough sales campaigns. And one that specifically comes to mind is the Japanese Airlines campaign for the 737s and the 787s. So can you talk to us about how the issue of trust and integrity, of course, in addition to our products, technical capabilities, became cornerstones of that campaign?
You know all my good stories. Huh? So what Marlene's talking about was we have had a phenomenal relationship with Japan, Boeing has, and Boeing and Japan have had this almost 50-year relationship of working together. And quite honestly, if you were to step back, it's, we almost have 100% market share in Japan when you look at Japan Airlines, what was JAS and ANA, all Nippon Airlines, and NCA, which is the cargo version of ANA. And we have one major competitor in the world, which is Airbus out of Europe. Now, we were in a campaign for 787s and 737s, and I was the chief engineer of the 737 at the time. And it was interesting because you have American culture, and you have Japanese culture, and you have European culture in this dynamic. And so, you know, clearly we have friends in Japan Airlines. And there was a little bit of a political thing going on inside Japan Airlines at the time, because Japan Airlines had just bought JAS, which was Japanese Air Service. JAS was traditionally a McDonnell Douglas operator. McDonnell Douglas no longer existed. So there was this dynamic where the JAS guys were lining up with the Airbus guys, and it was an internal power struggle going on inside the airline. And so Airbus was having was using that as their opportunity to get into Japan Airlines. And one time I got a call from our sales director and says, "Hey, Japan Airlines has, you know, just gotten a bunch of data from Airbus, and they came in and." Basically, they had this package that Airbus had shown to our customer, and it was very disparaging about the 737 product. And in fact, they had at one point showed them a picture of, I don't know if many of you are aware, but about 25, oh, maybe longer, probably 30 plus years ago, an Aloha Airlines 737, basically a lot of the top of the airplane in a widespread fatigue damage issue, where most of the top of the airplane came off and landed in Hawaii. One flight attendant was killed when the airplane damage occurred, but the rest of the passengers landed. There's a picture of the airplane on the tarmac with the passengers still in the seat with the damage. And Airbus used that picture in this campaign, which actually was interesting because they thought it was a very good idea, and it gravely offended the Japanese, and it, particularly Japan Airlines, if you understand the 747 accident that they had and how they approach accidents as a very personal and personal responsibility. But anyway, so they had shown all this stuff, and so I knew I couldn't go into Japan Airlines like I would an American customer and say, look, they just lied to you. I mean, because that would not work in Japan, right? So what we did was we knew Japan Airlines had 737-400s, which was an older version of the 737. And we took all the data associated with the 737NG, which is what we were selling at the time. And we used that to show all the improvements we had made in the airline. And like Airbus had said, we never tested the 737. And so what we did was we had a picture in the presentation of the test, the fatigue test article. But the point of the story was, And I went over with my entire engineering leadership team, and we spent, and Japan Airlines has a very sophisticated engineering department. And we spent 5 days with this airline, from 8 a.m. in the morning to about 8 o'clock at night. And just talking about every attribute of the airplane, from how the structure was designed, to how the decompression was calculated, to how the in-flight entertainment system was, to how the, every part of the airplane. So at the end of the fifth day, I was talking to their director of structures, and he said to me, I said to him, you know, well, thank you for your time this week, and I really appreciate you guys. You know, been here 12 hours a day with us. You know, it must have been a tough week. And I said, I understand you have Airbus coming in next week. I said, so, you know, you're going to have a couple of long weeks, and, you know, thank you for your team and your support. And he said to me, no, Delaney-san. He said, you're Boeing. We know you. This week was very easy. He goes, next week, he goes, Airbus is here. We don't know Airbus. Therefore, we can't trust them. Next week will be a long week for us, right? Now, that's a cool story, but the really cool part of the story was, and this was in their building at Haneda Airport. Prior to that meeting, I had never stepped foot in that building in Haneda, Japan before. And I had never met that man before, or his team before. But I was the chief project engineer of a Boeing 737, and with it, I carried 50 years of Boeing relationships with me. And so he wasn't saying, I trust you, Delaney-san. He said, I trust you, Delaney-san, because you are Boeing and because we have this relationship with you. And what I always tell my team is, if you ever violate that trust with him, you're not destroying a one-on-one relationship with the Japanese, you're destroying 50 years of relationship with that team. And most people don't understand that those encounters, when you represent your company, and when you do the right thing, or you have a conversation with them around the right things, the shadow of that is decades. And you could easily ruin that in a moment if you thought, you know, for the instant of selling a few 737s to compromise your integrity with that customer. And I think most people don't realize that those moments are when companies' character and reputation are really established. And you have to realize, and you might not even know you're in those moments, quite honestly.
That's really good, Mike, reminding us about reputation and ensuring it and protecting it. You know, Mike, let's go back to when you were the 787 chief engineer. You'll notice that he's been chief engineer on a number of programs at Boeing. And Mike, you had to make a difficult decision regarding the delay of that airplane's very first flight due to a side of body issue. And for those of you in the audience, you should know that the Dreamliner was already under intense public scrutiny, because at that time, many people, I'd say outside of our company, really didn't believe that we were going to deliver our first flight. And so the pressure was on, Mike. So talk to us about that.
Okay. How many in this group are engineers before I tell this story? All right, so I'm not going to feel bad for the few of you that are going to not gonna lose on this story. But So the side of body is how the wing is joined to the center section of the airplane and through the fuselage. So think about it, how the wing's joined to the body of the airplane. And we have a very, I'll say, traditional or standard way of doing that. And it involves a double plus cord on the top and a plate on the bottom and a rib. And it's how you basically take the loads, the air loads, through the wing and through the body and react to the loads. Now the 787 was a little unique because the way we wanted to assemble the airplane, typically we attach the side of body to the outboard wing, and then you wind up, if you think about the two stubs, and it slides right in. Well, in the 87, the way we wanted to do the assembly sequence, we actually wanted to put the fixed rib on on the fuselage and then slide it on the wing. And if you think about two spars that are not parallel, that are swept and dehedral-in-it, you can't basically slide it on. So we actually had to take something that was a monolithic structure and break it up into pieces. And the first time, unfortunately, you were able to test that and the load pass through that is when you go into the full-scale static fatigue test, where you take the airplane, you basically put it in a reaction rig, and you load up the flight loads on the airplane. And that was our static test airplane. In one of our run-ups and then eventually you test it to design load and then ultimate load, which is 150% of the design load of the airplane. And so on one of our run-ups to design load, which is what we needed to clear to fly the airplane, we saw it pop in one of the strain gauges. And so we went back and inspected the airplane, and we had a delamination in basically the, if you think about the, in the string, or it's what's called the noodle, but in the joint of the, where the web and the flange on a stringer would be. Now, unfortunately, what we missed was a very simple check of a beam on an elastic foundation. And being an aero guy, my structures books were in the garage, and I went and got my Timmy Oshenko books. I was hoping it was going to be like in some third appendix somewhere, and unfortunately it was page one of volume two, which made me feel really bad. But anyway, so we were trying to figure out, we had actually gotten to 103% of design load, and so we thought we could fly. And as Marlene said, we were trying to fly in June, we were already late, and we looked at it and we were trying to figure out if we could put a flight envelope together that was safe to operate in. And on a Wednesday night, the guys came in and they were looking at the end loads on the various stringers. And because you can't react to all the loads of the flight, because if you think about it, we got the bending, but you really can't get the engine loads. And so you're really testing the rear spar in this test. And as you move forward in the box, we were at much lower and lower levels of design limit load. And at one place where we had a delamination, we were only at about 56% of design load. So we knew we had no flight envelope. So it was a Wednesday night, and I went through with the structures guys, and said, okay, we're not gonna fly. So now I had to call the program manager. It was like 6:30 at night. Called him up and said, hey, and you know, looking at these loads, we're not gonna fly. He says, okay, let's get together tomorrow. Our chief technology officer flies out from Chicago. We bring in all the gray beards. We look at all the data. And we say, look, it's not going to happen. So the next morning, I was with our CEO. And the next afternoon, I was with our chairman. And the next morning, we were on an emergency phone call with our board of directors because this was now material information. The media would affect the stock price. And the interesting thing about that was, in that process, once I, as the chief engineer, made the decision that we were not going to fly, nobody up through the Board of Rescues even asked me, are you sure? And at this time, we were literally late. Now, the interesting thing, that the side effect of sometimes making that hard call, which seems, now we actually could have flown. We had enough of an envelope that we could have flown, but we wouldn't have been able to do a productive flight test program. And plus, we didn't want to risk having the flight test airplanes have the delamination. We wanted to do the modification while the structure was still pristine. So we didn't want to, but we could have. And the interesting thing is, up through our board of directors, nobody ever questioned me. But the interesting side effect was when Jim Okanowski, who was our chief structures engineer, and I penciled out the recovery plan. The original recovery plan was like 18 months when you laid in the test, the redesign, the finite element, getting the free body diagram right, getting all the way through the testing and modifying the airplanes. And the interesting thing was that so many people couldn't believe that we actually made the decision not to fly. People were working 20 and 22-hour days, and we actually flew less than 6 months from the day I made that decision. And on paper, we shouldn't have been able to do that for about 18 months. And so the positive reaction was people responded and said, okay, if you guys are going to do the right thing, then we're going to go the extra mile for you. and the team did a phenomenal job. And we actually flew on December 15th, which was a little less than 6 months from when we discovered the problem and made the decision not to fly. The thing that I was most proud of was that nobody up through the board of directors ever questioned the decision of why, or whether I was even sure or not. They just said, okay, are you, you know, let's go, we understand.
Yeah, that was a really tough time at the company, Mike, wasn't it? I mean, there was a lot of pressure, there was all that public scrutiny, but it was great to know, and we're all proud, that safety and the integrity of the product was a foremost thing for us. Mike, I remember a story that you told me about a sales campaign in Indonesia and Malaysia. And the part that struck me was how you said the real clincher in being able to close the deal was when the sales team brought in the engineers to talk about the planes to the customer. Do you recall that story?
Yeah, I think so. So what Marlene's talking, it's sort of, again, like the Japan Airlines story. We were in Indonesia, and we were trying to launch the 737-900ER. And we were working with our launch customer, which turned out to be Lion Air. And we were having a discussion, and Paul DeBeck was the sales director. And Paul brought my team and I down there, and he said, look, he goes, I need you to go in there and talk to these guys about the airplane, and I need them to understand the value of our airplane, and it's based on solid engineering and physics. He goes, because, you know, the other guys are in there basically, you know, trashing. So some of the things that our competitor does, which is, now I'll save that story for something, but they do interesting things. And so what we wanted to do was go in with the facts and the data. So they would go in and, for example, say, just tell Boeing to give you a 10% fee rate on the motors for maintenance costs. And what that says is how you set the thrust setting. And that doesn't work because the 737 is a lighter airplane, so you always set thrust lower. So the way the scale works, so you got to go into the airlines and spend some time with them talking about how the airplane actually operates, the weight comparisons of the airplane, why the airplane was lighter, why the maintenance program is better. And Paul said, the funny thing was, Paul said to my team, he goes, look guys, he goes, whatever you do, he goes, you guys are my white knights. He goes, you tell these guys the absolute truth. Where we're better, you tell them where we're better. Where we're not as good, you tell them where we're not as good. Where you tell it's neutral. He goes, if you mess up my campaign, he goes, I'll fix that. He goes, the one thing that I can never lose, because it's my ace in the hole, is Boeing's engineering team can never lose its integrity with the customer. Because that's the thing that I'm selling. He goes, because they're not just buying the airplane, they're buying the company. And he goes, the other guys are in there saying whatever it takes to win. He goes, you guys are the white knights here. And it was one of those things, because, you know, when you're in a campaign, it's, you can see where people could easily not answer a question. Maybe they're not, you know, the search for the perfect question, where maybe you don't lie, but you don't necessarily tell the unvarnished truth. And in reality, when you're in a campaign with a customer, typically if you tell them, because they know there's some places, you know, quite honestly, Airbus builds a pretty good airplane. You can't argue that we have more value in every case, but they're not, you can't, so you know there's some places that they're going to be advantage, just based on the design points, right? So you know that you have to be able to work through that. And Paul understood that. Paul understood he was not just selling hardware, he was selling a company, and he was selling a relationship, and he was selling a brand, and that no one campaign was worth diluting the brand of the company. And I think, you know, most people don't get exposed to that kind of element. And you know, our sales, like when we sold our recent sale to Lion Air, we sold $19 billion worth of airplanes. I mean, see, these are not inconsequential deals. I mean, these are big deals. And they matter to us, and they matter to the other guys, whether we win or not. And so it's just one of those things, and Paul is one of our best sales directors because the customers know that they can count on his word. And he brings that to the campaign.
And I think that's a great story, because when you told me this story, I was reminded again that Boeing has some good products. And by the way, that was nice that you said something good about Airbus, our competitor. But because, you know, I was reminded that Boeing sells good airplanes, but that's not the only thing we sell. We sell our commitment to integrity, is what we do. So Mike, another question for you here is, Boeing is known for forging solid customer relationships, as you well know, and focusing our energy on building the right product. So can you talk a little about Boeing's philosophy and how our team sometimes questions our strategy when it comes to our competitors? In other words, sometimes our own people want us to go for the jugular when it comes to talking about our competition.
Well, I think that's a follow on the previous question. So I think what you're referring to, I told you a story about a time I was with our customer engineers or the engineers that work with the airlines to configure their airplane. So by the way, when you don't like your seat on the airplane, we don't do that. That's the airline. So the legroom is not our issue, right? But anyway, but we have a group that customer engineers that work with the airlines, and they do things like select the interior, the spacing of the seats, how many first class, how many business class, you know, what brand of radios you want on the flight deck, you know, what options you want with the airplane. And they work a lot with the sales team. So I was talking to this group one day, and one of them said to me, you know, when are we going to fight back with Airbus? And I said, we're not going to fight back that way. And so here's sort of that. So I said something nice about Airbus, so I can say some other things now. So Airbus is the master of marketing, and they're a marketing machine compared to Boeing. And I mean, we pride ourselves on the technical and the airplane. They're good. So they'd go into an airline, and they would show. They'd say the doors on the 737 aren't comfortable, and they'd show this a cartoon of our door cutout. And they'd show a well-dressed man with a briefcase and a hat getting in and saying, look, he's going to have to bend his head and it's not comfortable, and here's our big door, right? Well, what they don't tell you is the door in the drawing is the number one right-hand door. So I always used to say to an airline, when was the last time you got on an airplane and through the service door, right? Typically, I mean, you've never boarded an airplane other than number one left, or maybe if you come back and number one right. Airplanes board on the left. The door on the left is a much bigger door because passengers walk in it. The door on the right is on the 737 is a smaller door because all they're doing is bringing food service. That's the food service door, right? Now, the different Airbus uses for manufacturing reasons the same size door on both. They basically use the same size door in every location on a 320. The difference between our door and their door is about 400 pounds to the airplane. So I always say to the people, I said, you know, you can get in our left side. And I said, by the way, you want to carry 400 pounds to altitude for the rest of the life of the airplane so that your guy that put food on the airplane is not going to bang his head? And they typically go, no, right? And then, you know, so Airbus will do a lot of things like that. And so these guys were asking me, you know, why don't we do stuff like that? You know, why don't we go back and attack their weaknesses? And they said, because I'm fundamentally, because we're not selling their deficiencies, we're selling the value of our airplane. Now, if you go into a 737 campaign, a 737-800 versus a 320, and if you don't lose because you can't get a schedule availability in production, you've done something wrong, because we have 13 more seats, we have more revenue, and we fly for less fuel. So you're gonna win on value, so you don't have to get down in the ditch to fight with them. But I was amazed at how many of our team got into that emotional response of, well, you know, they said bad things about us, how come we don't play that same card? And it's just one of those things. It's, you know, as soon as you start doing that, you start losing the value proposition, which is, hey, our airplane flies further, our airplane carries more passengers, and our airplane burns less fuel doing it. I mean, you know, you've got the trifecta of wins there, guys. Go with that, right? Because that's what, and then you can dollarize that. You can't dollarize emotion, right? And that's what you try to do. So, I mean, I think it's sort of a follow-on to the previous sort of concept.
Oh, okay, very good. Again, focusing on selling the integrity of our product. You know, we're going to open it up to you right now, and I'm really hoping that you have some questions for Mike. So how about a question from, oh, great.
So in the 90s, I think Airbus and Boeing went through a big battle of the four engine for long haul, and Boeing with the 777 with the TOPS program rolling out. What do you think that, where do you think like a next battle within between Boeing and Airbus in such big of a scale is going to come from in the next decade or so?
Well, so what you're alluding to was Airbus used to have Fly 4 for the long haul, and we were going against the 777. We have 75% market share, and they don't make that airplane anymore, right?
Yeah, I know. I mean, okay, in so terms of like,
just want to make sure everyone understood we won that one. but I think what you're, the next big one was really, so if you look at the industry, we predict based on a 3% global GDP, about a 5% passenger traffic growth and a 6% freight growth, which then leads to a requirement for about 30,000 airplanes over 20 years. And that's basis of business, right? And Airbus has a similar thing. They have a GMF and they have a similar kind of projections. But what you saw play out about 10 years ago and what's playing out today in the production system is those numbers are based on an unconstrained growth based on economics. So what are the constraints to growth? The constraints to growth are air traffic routes and the ability to land airplanes into a field, slots, landing slots, which is why you see companies like Boeing and others saying, hey, U.S. government, give off your tail, modernize the air traffic system, because the air traffic system in the U.S. is a constraint to the growth of the economy. Now, we took two different approaches to solving that problem. So Airbus, what they did was they believed that the solution to the congestion or the constraints of the growth would be alleviated through the use of the hub and spoke system. And so that's why they developed the A380. And by the way, we did everything on earth we could to encourage them to spend their money on that airplane. I mean, we had a team whose sole job it was in the Boeing company was to get them to launch that airplane, because we knew it was going to tie up their capital for a long time. Now, Boeing's approach was very different. We believed in smaller airplanes, super efficient, flying point to point. And while Tokyo is one of my favorite places on the planet, I don't really want to go to Narita when I really want to go to Indonesia or Kuala Lumpur. And so our view was the other way to solve congestion was have super efficient airplanes flying point to point. And so instead of going into the big hub and spoke system, just fly directly where you want. And can be modeled to solve that. That's where the 787 came from. You know, an 8,000 nautical mile airplane in the 767 size, whereas a 67 was only about a 6,300 nautical mile airplane. Same thing with the 777. That's also the same thing where you see, you know, going for the large ETOPS numbers or the extended twin operations where 330 minutes on a single engine. That's where you'll see, that's playing out today in the sales campaign. I think Airbus has seen that, you know, with the A340 not working out, they've retrenched to the A350, which is a twin. And so the next real key will be who can deliver the best economics and the most efficient airplanes so that the airlines can increase their yields and increase their profitability. And you know, airlines are going to be under pressure. There's a lot of places where, you know, green is very important. So you see a lot of investment in engines and noise abatement, things like that. But I think when you look at it today, the modern fleet is going to look like a 3-7 size airplane. I think there's going to be a 5-7 kind of replacement in the future. There'll definitely be the 8-7 size airplane. And then there'll be the 777, big 777. I don't think there's going to be a lot of units sold in the A380, and I think the 47, you know, eventually the 777 will start moving into that space. And so I think the battleground will be on highly integrated airplanes. So the thing that the 87 did and why the 87 is so much more efficient than any other airplane ever built, and why it's so much more efficient even than the A350, is, you know, we used to tell the story about aerodynamics, composites, and the engines. But in reality, it's the integration of those three. And so when you take the 87, and Airbus hasn't done this yet. So when you take the 87 and you integrate the flight control laws, and you use the flight control laws to use maneuver load alleviation, and then you tailor that with the composite structure, and you could tailor that with the electric jet, the integrated effect is much greater than the sum of the individual parts. And so right now, when we look at the 350, they're still in a federated design, and they need, they'll figure it out. They'll go the next step, but, you know, and then we'll go the next step. And highly integrated systems and structures and airplane efficiency will drive the next step. And that's, I mean, the 87 really, if you were to design the airplane classically, like a 777 or 67, the 87 would weigh about 8,000 pounds more. We took about 8,000 pounds of structural weight out by using the flight controls to actively tailor the wing aerodynamic loads and maneuver load alleviation. And that's really going to be the next step, because there's no size airplane. The airplane size and spectrum is done, and we'll just compete on who can bring the most value to the individual customers.
Now, that was a great question, obviously, because he really, can you tell he really likes what he does? Okay, I saw someone in the back. You with the tie?
Yeah. If you don't mind, two questions, please. One, you talk about ethics of business. As a U.S. firm, we have to be on the Corrupt Practices Act. I don't know if Airbus is so constrained. How has that affected you and affected the marketplace, or has it not at all? The other is, you mentioned the JAL 747 crash. Whatever I know is from the press, you know better than I, but they talked about a triple redundant system failing. Which leads to the question, how do you engineer that level of redundancy into things as complicated as an airplane with millions of parts? How do you identify all the systems, all the failure points? It doesn't just happen.
No. Okay, so two questions, really long questions. So what was the first one again?
Sorry about that.
Get to
the first one was about, does the partner of the SAC get to come into play if you're a U.S. firm or their own?
We have to abide by it. We play by the rules. They play by the rules where they are. We have to go in and win on value. We have to comply with all the corrupt foreign corrupt practices act. If you looked in my bio, I went to school in Toulouse, France for a while. I got my MBA in Toulouse as part of a Boeing executive education. The person who did the industry person who led the legal part of our MBA program was actually the chief counsel of a major airline in Europe. And the interesting thing is he was teaching about the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act. And what he said was, these Americans and their ethics, he goes, why would you ever constrain yourself like that? He goes, what do you care about if a foreigner loses their soul? Right? So you figure out the answer from that response to you. Now, the second part, more engineering based, redundancy is the key to how we get the reliability. So the airplane, if you think about it, and this is sort of my closing discussion, it's probabilistic is how we approach it. So there is no, you remember Al Gore, Zero Accidents Initiative, right? Okay. Park all the airplanes and, you know, get in trains, I guess, is the way to get there. You can't get there, right? How we design the airplane is basically to a probability of 10 to the minus 9. One in a billion, one in a billion events, one in a billion flight hours, one in a billion takeoffs and landings. And so how you do that is you would sit there and say, okay, look at a hydraulic system. And you say a hydraulic system is about a 10 to the minus 3, 10 to the minus 4 at its failure. And so what do? All modern commercial airplanes have at least three hydraulic systems. because you put three N gates together and you get 10 to the minus, simply 10 to the minus 3 plus 10 to the minus 3 plus 10 to the minus 3. It's a 10 to the minus 9th event that you would completely lose all hydraulic systems. And then you look at the vulnerabilities, so areas where the three hydraulic systems come together, and one was most famously found when Sioux City happened, the DC-10 accident where the fan rotor disintegrated and took out all the hydraulic lines, right? So now you have airplanes that have fuses in them. So in areas where you can, you isolate. So there's hydraulic fuses. And so you have a series of things that you do it. So that's architecturally how you do it. But what you do from a design practice is you have what are called failure hazards and effects. So you look at all the failure hazards and effects, and you look at what's called FMEAs, or failures and effects modes analysis. And they're very detailed at the complete system level. So when I talked about when I was running SR88, the failure and effects modes analysis for one airplane's fuel tank, what we submitted to the FAA was over 50,000 pages of analysis. And that's the way you have to do it. And now today when you get into things like the 787's power system. So if you look at the power system on a traditional airplane, it has about six states. And so you test it in a lab. You know, you got six, think about it this way. You got a power system with six switches. And you can go on, off, 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 off. On, off, off, off. And you can work through that in a system, in a lab, and deterministically. Well, the 787, to get its efficiencies, its electrical power system has 2^38 states. So we calculated one time, if you did 10 a second, it was like 300,000 years to deterministically do it. So we figured we probably wanted to put the airplane in service before that was finished. So what we did was, in that case, that's where you do things like, you know, software in the loop, and you run simulations to run through all the fault trees. And you run through 10 to the minus 38 states in a software simulation to go through the state machine so you can identify those effects and modes. And if you looked at it, you know, we have a whole reliability and maintain R&M department, reliability and maintainability, and they track every part on the airplane. What's the mean time between first failure? What's the mean time between unscheduled removal? All those maintenance metrics around every piece of the airplane. And those real data go back into those fault trees that I talked about. And that's how, and you look at a valve and you say, hey, a valve here is good to 10 to the minus 4, or an engine failure, and that's how you get to the ETOPS. You know, an engine will shut down at about 10 to the minus 4 kind of rate, and so that's how you get to the single engine failures. And the airplane is fundamentally designed for no single failures being able to take the airplane down. But the only thing you can get that really can do is common cause, like, you fly the airplane through a volcanic ash cloud, one engine breaks up and the disc goes around and takes out the other engine. That's about the only single point failure left, and you can't design around that. I mean, you fundamentally can't get around that. But other than that, everything else is redundant.
Okay.
One more?
I have one question.
Okay.
Oh, she has a question.
Go ahead.
So you talked a lot about Boeing's ethics and how you ensure things, but oftentimes in engineering today, you have to work with other companies, particularly, I guess in Boeing's case, maybe the companies that are making your engines and things like that. How do you go about ensuring that your partners also have the same values and ethics that you do?
Well, you pick your suppliers carefully, right? That have, and most of the people that are in our supply base today grew up through the jet age. So General Electric, Pratt & Whitney, Honeywell, which was Sperry at one time, all those companies, right? And then you know, as President Reagan said, you trust but verify, right? I mean, so we review every analysis that comes into us, and you work your way through that. And you wind up in a situation where you have to spend a lot of time with suppliers. So I mean, one time when I was chief engineer of the 737, and the economic pressures on these small companies can be very difficult. So, well, there's a rod that was part of the redesign. And the end of the rod is made out of a very hard material that has to be plated, masked, and heat treated, right? And it's this part is made in Massachusetts in this little economy that, you know, machines it, sends it out, plates it, heat treats it, blah, blah, blah. Then the part's shipped to California and assembled into a rod to one of our major suppliers, and then it comes to 737. But we found one of those ends broken about 10 days before Christmas one year. And it was in 600 737s that we had delivered, and it was in 3,000 kits to be retrofitted in. And I was on the phone with this small company, all these small companies, and here's the big bad chief engineer of the Boeing company, right? And we're trying to figure out what, and by the way, Southwest is inspecting airplanes at night for us to see what's going on. I mean, this is a big deal. And I remember being on the phone, and these two little companies were like, well, you know, we had an emergency board meeting last night, because they're sitting there going, hey, we delivered 3,000 of these to the Boeing in this classic, and we delivered 600 of them in the NG. And they're thinking, hey, the Boeing company and the airlines are coming after us. And finally I said to the guy, look, these two companies, I said, look, if you tell us the truth and you give us access to all the information, this will be okay. If you don't, it's going to be the worst thing you ever did in your life. Make sure we want to know your processes, we want to know the handling, we've got to understand this. If you help us understand this, we'll fix it and it'll be okay. And we had to tell them, look, we weren't going to come back at them and try to get recuperate costs. I mean, we'd collapse half our supply base, right, if we did things like that. So we know there are times that people are going to make mistakes out in the supply base, and we don't punitively go after them. I mean, we had every right to them. I mean, they made a manufacturing flaw that by contract rights we could have went after. But what I said to them was, don't do that. I said, just tell us, we need to know, because it's more important that we understand what happened. And we understood, because what we were trying to figure out was the exposure rate. Because we had to understand, because what happened is if you had three failures, there's three rudder rods, and if you had three failures, you could have a catastrophic loss of the airplane. And now you have a problem, you have a specific manufacturing flaw you have to deal with. So it's not just probabilistic anymore, you're dealing with a specific risk. And so what we were trying to do is understand how many lots were exposed, was it all of them, what was the potential likelihood that an airplane had three failed links in it. And you have to work your way through that. But you've got to ensure this this supplier that says, look, you know, do the right thing and we will treat you fairly. But if you don't, you know, then we're going to bring all the weight of the Boeing Corporation down. And quite honestly, you know, sort of in closing, you know, engineers think engineering is black and white, but it really isn't. I mean, if you think about it, and that's the biggest challenge you have is, I mean, and I tell my engineers this all the time, do not confuse precision for accuracy. Just because your calculator gave you 8 digits doesn't mean it's accurate, right? And every analysis has an assumption or a border where it breaks down. So everybody in this room knows that kinetic energy is 1/2 mv², right? What happens when you start going 0.99 of the speed of light? Don't work anymore, right? So you just need to understand it's not always black and white, right? And what your job is as an engineer is to apply the science, make the world better, create these great products, but understand that there's a gray area and there's limitations, and that's where when you get to the ethics in engineering, it's about how you make those decisions in the gray space. It's about how when you're sitting there looking at a 737 in an engineering investigation board, you go, wow, you know, we just saw this fire on the airplane. Well, you can't ground 6,000 737s. You'd ruin the economy, right? So you have to understand the risk. You have to understand the exposure. When you're doing an analysis, it's always going to be based on the underlying assumptions. And the key part as engineers is really how well you understand those assumptions and then what knowledge you can bring to your company so that you can make good decisions. And that's where engineers are at their most value, because there you're adding value to your company, because you're sitting there saying, hey, this is where we are, this is what the data says. Now, we know we make mistakes, right? So to the gentleman's question back, that's why we have redundant systems, because we know there isn't gonna be perfection in the system. And what you gotta avoid is that it's black and white, engineering, you know, it's a hard science, it is. You know what I always used to do? This will go off on a little tangent, but it's important. So I used to spend most of my career doing performance, basically aerodynamic performance of the airplane. So when you figure out how far an airplane flies, you know, the Breguet range equation is fundamentally based on the aerodynamics of the airplane and the SFC of the engine, right? And that's really important to understand the relationship of the fuel burn and the thrust calculation. Now, you can't measure thrust in flight, right? So no matter how good you are, it will always be an approximation. And when I was a lead engineer and running the aero group, I used to tell my lead engineers or my engineers, I said, you want to understand in-flight thrust determination? What you should go read is Plato's Allegory of the Cave, right? You know that one? Where what is really truth? And so engineers can get wrapped up in this thing that says, I know the answer. I'll tell you what, nobody on earth knows the exact thrust-drag relationship of the 787. But the Boeing company and General Electric company have figured out a method of you run the engine on the ground and you have a force trunnion and you make these corrections. They're fudge factors, but we call them coefficients, right? Okay. And we go and get the velocity and discharge coefficients, and we get up to flight and we measure and infer the Mach number and all the other things, right? And at the end of the day, we do as best as we can in engineers. But don't fool yourself that that's the right answer as God would know it, right? And that's the key thing, because when you get it, you understand the limitations of your analysis, and that's where your judgment comes in, and that's where you're going to be most valuable for your company. And that's where you have to have that compass. And I think Boeing, I thought about this a lot, I think Boeing's compass comes from the fact that every one of us have spent a lot of time investigating accidents. And we understand that, you know, a lot of things have happened in the jet age. And while it is the safest mode of transportation on the planet, when something happens, it's usually pretty dramatic. And all of the things that you look at, or many of the things that you look at, were lessons learned from very hard lessons, or very hard experiences. And that inner peace, when you understand, and I one of my friends who's an executive said to me one time, when he was first day on the job, he was doing a stress analysis, and he was doing a repair on a 47, and he said to his lead, I'm done. And he said, did you check it? He goes, yeah, I checked it. He goes, did you check it? Like 400 people's lives are dependent on it. It's a very different answer, right? So understand that it's that judgment and that compass that is gonna make you great. And with that, I thank you for your time and attention.
I want to thank Mike and Marlene for this incredible presentation. I just want to personally thank them because I was in August on a flight, which I told them about, on United Airlines to Berlin from Newark, a 757. As we took off, one of the front wheels, the tire blew. Flew into the front engine, one of the engines. We were off the ground already. The plane was shaking like you can't imagine. And there was a fire. People were screaming. The engine's on fire. For a couple minutes, people were screaming. And finally, the thing was turned off and the fire stopped. And when I came out, and everything was fine. I'm obviously here. I didn't parachute out to Columbia. We landed and everything was fine. And what it made me feel was these planes are really well built. And they were made so they could deal with a situation like that. And I feel very grateful to Mike in particular for designing such robust planes. And but aside from my personal thanks, I want to thank him and Marlene from all of us. This was an inspiring set of discussions. I was sitting here absolutely enthralled by his stories, And I hope that you have the same feeling that I have, that you're motivated to pursue a career, whichever way your engineering education takes you, with the same principles and the same compass that he has shown that Boeing follows. So thank you very much.